Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to show you how to simulate the Moran model with selection. So I'm going to obviously quickly remind you about the definition of the model. We are going to look again at the basic properties, transition rights, transition probabilities, and so on. And I'm going to show you how we can simulate the process, like show you some algorithm. And then after, we look at some actual program to simulate this Moran model with selection. So I remind you that in the Moran model with selection, you have two types of individuals that we typically call mutants. And they are going to have a fitness that we call phi, and the resident. And those residents, they have fitness one. Typically, we assume that the mutant has a higher fitness. And the system consists of a population of exactly n individuals with mutant and residents. And at each time step, you are going to choose an individual at random for reproduction, but at random, but not uniformly at random. You are going to choose individuals with a probability proportional to their fitness. So that means that any single mutant is more likely to be chosen for reproduction than any single resident. Once you have identified an individual that is going to be the individual that is going to give birth to a new offspring, an offspring of its own type, then you need to send the offspring to a site that you choose uniformly at random. And so we are going to choose one of those n individuals uniformly at random and replace this individual by the offspring. So that's kind of the way the process works. So now, if you keep track of the number of mutants in the system, this gives you a discrete time Markov chain with state space 0, 1, and so on up to n. N is the total number of individuals in the system. And now from any site or from any state x, you can jump to x plus 1 or x minus 1, but you can also stay at x. So you have those jumps, and you can also stay at x. And so the whole thing, everything we have to do to really simulate this process is find the transition probabilities, which we already did in a previous video. So I'm going to tell you about that quickly. And then from that, you just need at each time step to generate a discrete random variable that is going to have range of size 3, because you have 3 possible outcomes at each update. And then from that, you by again doing at each time step, like producing, like simulating this random variable whose parameter is going to change, it's going to depend on x, you are going to eventually build like this your process. So first step is to find those transition probabilities. So now the first thing to observe is that the fitness, the overall fitness of mutants. And so now we are going to assume that x is the number of mutants, okay? So in this case, because each mutant has fitness phi, all them together, they are going to have fitness phi times x. All the residents together, they are going to have fitness. So I'm looking at the cumulative fitness of all the individuals of the same type. So of residents, now it's going to be equal to the 1 times the number of residents. That's going to be n minus x. And then from that, we can get those probability of going from x to x plus 1 or x to x minus 1. So what is the probability of going from x to x plus 1? Well, first we said we choose an individual at random, but with probabilities proportional to their fitness. So that means that the probability of going from x to x plus 1 is the probability that at least we have to choose a mutant for reproduction. And so we have to start with a term that corresponds to the probability of choosing a mutant. We know that because they are chosen with probabilities proportional with their fitness, that should be the overall fitness of the mutant divided by the overall fitness of all the individuals. So that's going to be phi x divided by phi x plus this term, n minus x. So this is the probability of the probability that a mutant is indeed going to give birth. Now, so that we indeed go to x plus 1 and don't stay at site x, at in state x, we need also to make sure that the mutant, the offspring of this mutant is going to be sent to a site occupied by a resident. And so we need to multiply by a number of sites occupied by residents, that's n minus x, divided by the total number of sites. So that's of the form also 1 minus x over n. Okay, so that gives you the probability of going from x to x plus 1, and then probability of going from x to x minus 1 is, following the same idea, fitness of the resident, that's n minus x, divided by overall fitness, that's again phi x plus n minus x, times the probability that the offspring of this resident is sent to a mutant, is going to replace a mutant, that's exactly the fraction of sites that are occupied by mutants. You have x sites, x mutant for n sites, so that gives you x over n. And that's it, we have our two probabilities of going from x to x plus 1, x to x minus 1. Be careful, those two ones do not add up to 1. You have a third possible transition. We can stay at site, at state x, and but that doesn't really matter. We don't really need to find explicitly this value. We know that this value is going to be like pxx, that's going to be 1 minus the sum of those two ones. So now, to simulate this then, I'm going, for instance, to call that p plus, to say that we add one mutant in the process, and this one p minus, the minus means we remove one mutant, then we can generate the process using, again, a bunch of uniform random variables. Remember, uniform, it's basically the only thing that basic languages like C can do. So you start with a uniform at each time step, you take a uniform random variable in the interval 0, 1, okay? And then to decide at each step if you are going to add one individual or remove one individual and or don't do anything, you need to simulate this this kind of discrete random variable with three possible outcomes, negative 1, 0, and plus 1, with those probabilities. And so what you are going to do is just look at the interval 0, 1 again, split the intervals into three pieces. The length of each sub-interval is going to correspond to those three probabilities. So you can do, for instance, p plus here, then p plus plus p minus. Then if you add up this, the probability of staying in x, you are going to be in state, you are going to be at 1. And so now you look at the value of this uniform. If you are here, then you are here with probability p plus, you are going to add 1 to the population, so you do a plus. If at the opposite you are between those two values that occurs with probability the length of this interval, that's p minus, you are going to remove one individual from the system, and if you fall in this interval, you do nothing. Okay? So you see that here, most of the work was to write those transition probabilities, which is something, in fact, I already did before in another video. But then once you have this, that's pretty easy using a bunch of uniform random variable to decide at each update whether you have one more mutant, one less mutant, or no change. So now let's look at an actual computer program that simulates this process. So here is the program. As usual, we start by invoking some libraries that we typically need. Now we need two specific parameters that are going to be fixed once for all. The fitness of the mutant, I'm going to fix that equal to 2, I'm calling it phi. And then also the total number of individuals in the system, I fix this n to be 50. Then after we need, again, a bunch of variables, x and n, that's going to be x for the process itself, the process that keeps track of the number of mutants. That's going to be, of course, an integer, and n is the time. Now we are back to discrete Markov chains, so the time is an integer. And also a bunch of real numbers, so that's those floats, that we are going to look at the interpretation of that, but all those numbers are basically the kind of overall fitness of one or the other type of individuals, or the probability of selecting a resident or a mutant for reproduction and for replacement. So again, after below that, you have this always same subroutine, float uniform that chooses a number uniformly at random in the interval 0, 1. And then let's look at the right hand side now of the screen. Now here we have our main program. We again start with the same three lines to choose a seed of for the pseudo-random generator. And the seed again is based on the actual time of the computer. Then I'm going to fix X that keeps track of the number of mutants in the system. I'm going to fix it equal to 1 initially. N is also fixed at the beginning of the program equal to 0, that's generation 0. And then we have everything, I mean, most of what I explained on the board is written in this while loop. That's the main part of the algorithm. So we are going to ask the computer to work as long as x is different from 0 and x is different from n. That's the same condition as for the gambler process. We just have, I mean, we know that the process is going to evolve until all the individuals are of the same type, which are basically two absorbing states, all residents or all mutants. So that's what this condition means. Then what are we going to do at each time step? Well, first we need to add 1 to the time variable n. That's not completely necessary in the program, that's just so that we can after display the time at which things happen. Then after I'm going to define those two quantities, f0 and f1. These are floats, like real numbers. In fact, the first one is in fact an integer, but is going to be treated in a float command after, so that's why maybe I call it float here. But f0 is going to be n minus x, that's the number of sites occupied by a resident that corresponds to the overall fitness of all the residents. So that's what we wrote on the board before. Then we have f1 that is analog to f0, but now for mutants, it's phi times the total number of mutants, phi times x, total number of mutants in the system, that's the overall fitness of the mutant. And then after I'm going to define, so those fractions, so these are probabilities, so s is going to be overall fitness of the mutant divided by the overall fitness of all the individuals. S is in fact the probability of choosing a mutant for reproduction. I'm using the letter S for selection. So it's probably of selecting a mutant for reproduction. Then F for fraction of space. The fraction of space occupied by mutant, that's going to be X over N. And then from that, we can easily, from those quantities, S and F, we can easily rewrite the two transition probabilities I wrote on the board that I call P plus and P minus, that here in the program I'm calling P1 and P0. That's the probability of birth of a mutant and probability of, instead of birth, I should say probability that we have one more mutant in the system, or probably that we have one more resident in the system. So that's exactly S times 1 minus F. That's probability of selecting a mutant for reproduction times the fraction of space occupied by a resident. And then for P0, you have it the other way around. It's going to be 1 minus S. It's probability now, instead of choosing a resident, for selection, times F, fraction of space occupied by mutants. So that's exactly what we did on the board. And then after, exactly like I showed you, how can we generate a discrete random variable with three possible outcomes? That's what we do here. We take a uniform random variable in the interval 0, 1, invoking the subroutine uniform. So we have this little u that is uniform in the interval 0, 1. And then after we test, if u is less than p1, which is something that happens with probability p1, then we add one mutant to the system. So that's this x++. Now, the opposite, if u is larger than p1 but less than p1 plus p0, which occurs with probability p0 exactly, then we are going to remove one mutant from the system, which is equivalent to also adding a resident in the system. And we don't need to care about the condition where u would be larger than p1 plus p0, because in this case, nothing happens. Okay, you have a resident replacing a resident, or a mutant replacing a mutant. And so as usual, we close the while loop by a printf command, so that we can see on the screen what the computer is doing. And here, as usual, we are going to write a pair of numbers. Both are integers. The first one is the time of the system, like the time variable. The other one is the number of mutants in the system. And as usual, like I explained in the previous videos, you can use this program as a starting point, include another loop in the program, like a for loop, for instance, where you can run your program maybe 1,000 times. And then after this 1,000 of realization, independent realization of the process, you can look at the fraction of time we ended up with fixation to the whole mutant configuration, or the whole resident configuration. And from that, using also the law of large number, you can deduce an approximation of the probability of the mutant is indeed going to invade the population. So that's one first modification you can do. And obviously, as usual, you can also couple your program with a graphical interface to have some kind of nice features. And here I'm showing you, for instance, examples of realization of the Moran model. Here, instead of starting with one mutant and in a population of all residents, I'm looking at the Moran model without selection. So that's called the neutral Moran model, where we just have two types of individuals with the same fitness. And we start with 50% of individual of type 0, 50% of individual of type 1, and we see what happens, and we get all those curves from the program I just showed you.